of the effects of branching on rheology of polyethylene bombs using a molecular dynamics simulation. And this work has been done in collaboration with Gary Gress at Sandia National Labs. As we all know, Professor Bill Gressley had done numerous different studies to understand the effects of branching on polymer rheology. And this study is also inspired by his brilliant work. Capturing the broad time and length scales associated with polymeric motions remains a challenge. To overcome this challenge, we developed a coarse-grained model for polyethylene, as Gary Gress previously described, and here, specifically, we are adding coarse-grained branches. Using this newly developed coarse-grained model, we will be able to focus into the molecular aspects of these polyethylene combs for broad time scales. And using this model, we are extracting the effects of branching on chain mobility and the viscous response. Polymer topology or its architecture is an important factor to determine polymer mechanical properties and its processability. Here in this cartoon, we see different polymer topologies ranging from linear polymers to more complex polymer forms. Flory and Fox first found the effect of molecular rate on the zero shear viscosity of flexible linear polymers. They have shown that at low molecular weights, zero shear viscosity is proportional to the molecular weight, and at high molecular weights, it is proportional to the third power of the molecular weight. And the question here is, will this relationship still last if we change the polymer topology by adding branches? This is nicely captured in this work from Dave Loshi and co-workers, where they have measured the viscosity as a function of shear rate for three different polymer topologies, which are linear, three-arm-star, and four polyethylenes. Here we see that the linear chains and the three arms have same molecular weight, but they have different values for zero shear viscosity with different onsets of shear thinning. And also, here we have combs and three-arm stars which have different molecular weights, but they have same values for the zero shear viscosity even though they have different onsets for shear thinning. This shows that for the branched polymers, the rheology is not only dependent upon the molecular weight, but also on their branch length and number of branches. So the goal of this study is to understand effects of branching on polymer mobility as well as the viscous response using our coarse-grained model. The coarse-grained potentials are derived from the all-atom NV simulations of polyethylene melts, where we represented these molecules using OPLS force fields, and the simulations were carried out using LAMS NV code. This cartoon here shows a coarse-grained polyethylene model where the backbone is represented in the purple and the arms or the branches are shown in red. With coarse-graining, we can find four carbon atoms in order to form one coarse-grained bead. In this study, we control the backbone length as follows. And also we control the arm length from 0 to 160 carbons. So we have branches which are above and below the entanglement length of polyethylene. And also we control the number of branches from 0 to 16. In this study, we made sure that we are in the comb region because end-to-end distance of the comb backbone is independent from the number of branches and the branch length. Now let's see the effect of branching on chain mobility. This graph measures the mean square displacement as a function of time for linear polyethylene. And the time is scaled by a scaling factor in order to overlap with the all-atom NV simulation details. Here, this curve represents the mean square displacement of the entire chain, and this represents the mean square displacement of center CG peaks. We see that at longer times, these two overlap, showing that the chain has reached into its diffusive regime. Time where it achieves in the diffusive regime is its diffusive time. Now let's add branches and see what happens. Here we are adding four branches, each has a length of 40 carbons. We see when we add branches, chains reach into the diffusive regime at much longer times. And when we keep increasing the branch length, we see that they reach into their diffusive time at much longer times. This seems that this shows that the presence of branches and increasing the branch length reduces the chain mobility. This can be explained by this cube model where we assume these chains rotate in this cube with the diameter of d. When we increase the branch length, the tube diameter increases. However, the mobility suppresses due to the additional entanglements caused from these branches. Now let's compare the mobility of the linear and branch polyethylenes by measuring the diffusion coefficient measured at the diffusive regime. At diffusive regime, diffusion coefficient is given by the mean square displacement of these chains divided by the time. This graph shows the diffusion coefficient as a function of total number of carbons for linear and polyethylenes. These polyethylene forms have the same molecular weight as the linear ones. In these forms, we fix the branch backbone length and only vary the branch length. We see that these forms diffuse move slower compared to the linear ones, even though they have shorter backbones. And also we see that when we increase the total number of carbons, the mobility of the both cases decreases as expected. The mobility of the linear chains can be explained using this exponent. However, the forms do not follow this exponent. And we see that the forms with shorter arms show about two-fold of decreasement in their mobility compared to linear chains with the same molecular weight. And we see that the forms with longer arms show about three-fold of decreasement in their mobility compared to linear chains with the same molecular weight. This shows that the presence of increase in the branch length of the forms reduce their mobility. So far, we have seen the effect of branch length on the chain mobility. Let's look at the effect of number of branches on chain mobility next. Here we are measuring the diffusion coefficient as a function of number of branches for the forms with fixed branch length. We can see at fixed branch length, when we increase the number of branches, the mobility decreases linearly, which is very interesting. And now we are focusing into the molecular level to understand this linear behavior. Here, we are measuring the diffusion coefficient as a function of number of branches for the chains with same molecular weight. This here represents the diffusion coefficient for the linear chain, and these are for the branches, for the forms. When we increase the number of branches in these forms, to keep the molecular weight constant, we are decreasing the branch length. We see that the form with lower number of longer branches show a significant decrease in mobility compared to the linear chain with the same molecular weight. And with the form mobility increases gradually when we have forms with higher number of shorter branches. This shows that at fixed molecular weight, the form mobility is more affected by the branch length rather than the number of branches. Finally, let's look at the effect of branching on viscous response of these chains. Here we are measuring the viscosity as a function of shear rate for the forms with different branch lengths. We see that when we increase the branch length, the viscosity increases. The viscosity measured with this plateau region, which is the zero shear viscosity, is plotted as a function of branch length of here. We see that when we increase the branch length, the zero shear viscosity increases exponentially, which is in good agreement with Professor Wilkerson's work as well. Finally, here we are measuring the viscosity as a function of shear rate for the chains with same molecular weight. This curve represents the viscosity of the linear chain, and these are for the branches. We see at fixed molecular weight, the linear chain records the highest viscosity. And the branches, among the branches, the ones with higher number of shorter branches show lowest viscosity, while the forms with lower number of longer branches show higher viscosity. With that, I would like to conclude my talk. We found that at fixed molecular weight, the chain mobility is mainly governed by the branch length and then the number of branches. And also we saw in the forms, when we increase the branch length, the zero shear viscosity increases exponentially. And our post-grad model is capturing all those details and is working very nice. Well, in future, we would like to study the effect of polyspecificity of number of branches and the branch length on polymerology. With that, I would like to thank NSF for funding I'm a cluster and I'm a senior lecturer lab. Thank you.
We looked at the wave-factor dependence of the intermediate scattering function, so that one could make a connection between the scattering experiment.
Obviously, we will be doing that in future because our group is doing a lot of neutron scattering experiments. So that's one of the next goals to study the neutron behavior of these samples.
Is it possible to get to lower shear rates in your simulation? It could quite seem like you got to zero shear rates.
No, because if we carry out those simulations, it will take a whole lot of time.
Right.
But when we see the plateau region, we know that it has reached into the zero shear viscosity. But if we won't run into the zero shear viscosity, absolute zero, no, it will take a whole lot of time for the bigger system, especially.
So maybe you're better off doing like a step stream experiment.
Yes.
Can you do green Kubo in zero?
What's that?
Can you do like a green Kubo calculation in the to get the Newtonian response from the equilibrium system?
Yes, we have done, you know, we have measured the G of T stress sort of correlation, and then from there to the plateau region, we can get an idea of the mean stress displacement.